just started.
Okay. Hey, welcome back to, or welcome to another episode of Gnostic Deluge.
It's kind of welcome back, because we just did the previous one. We're looking at our clothes.
We had a little break.
I was going to bring a separate shirt to change.
I was going to grow a beard. But between sessions.
So it looked like we did this on a different day.
Well, so anyway, so we just had the introduction, kind of background of the Book of Enoch, but actually I just, in the kind of to link this with this one with our previous ones on the Book of Adam and Eve.
We have a good segue.
Yeah, there. There's in chapter 22 of the second Book of Adam and Eve, chapter 22, verse 2, it says, "It is this Enoch to whom many wonders happened, and who also wrote a celebrated book. But those wonders may not be told in this place." So we're going to tell you about those wonders in this place, in this video. And so anyway, this goes back to the introduction, though, to where they were talking about how Enoch was like this... people knew about Enoch.
Yeah.
Even in separate scriptures.
And separate... Well, I'm not going to go into this right now. We won't go into this, but separate cultures, too.
Yeah.
So we'll do that. Yeah, we'll do another video on that.
So they're, you know, I mean, they allude to Enoch So anyway, we're going to get into some of those stories. Unfortunately, in the Lost Book of the Bible and the Forgotten Books of Enoch, Eden, their Enoch is the second Enoch, which isn't a very good one. It's not that interesting. It's just kind of him getting taken up into heaven. And
it's called The Secrets of Enoch.
Yeah, and it's the Slavonic.
Slavonic.
Yeah. Anyway, so it's not like we're going with the first Book of Enoch, the Ethiopic.
Yeah. Ethiopic or Ethiopic. We don't know how you pronounce that.
What do you want, Brandon?
I want to finish this.
Well, here. Brandon brought volcano water. So. It took a long time to cool down.
It's actually still a little warm.
Super hot.
It looks like it's sweating, but.
And I'm going to drink a Verner's.
Verner's?
Yeah.
I actually knew they had Verner's. I'm just joking. So this is a deep, it says deep well water, but it's actually out of a volcano.
Yeah.
Boy. Hawaiian volcanic water. I think this is the one. Did you already drink out of
water?
One? Did you already drink out of one?
Yeah, is that the one that's open?
Come on, Mark.
I thought that was it.
Germs, man.
Wait, you don't want to get germs? Oh.
Okay. Yeah, this is not open.
Anyway. Yet. Oh, so you're worried about me getting my cuties? All right, fine.
Come on. It burns.
Tastes like water to me.
Yeah.
But it's supposed to have electric light. Or electrolytes. Electric lights.
It has electric lights.
Anyway, so speaking of volcanoes and mountains, let's get into
There's no volcano, but there is a mountain.
So how are we gonna make this transition in the Book of Adam and Eve, we talked about the fall of men coming off the mountain.
Yep.
And
that was kind of one of the last things that happened.
Yeah.
Was there was this situation where the people of Seth, or a group of them, were kind of watching.
There was 100.
The partying going down in the valley, and there we had that cool picture we showed you. That was an old one, but it's a picture of the people of Seth on the mountain. And they're looking down and they're over and they're looking at all the people dance and like party because this guy apparently came down. Somebody taught them all.
Yeah, how
to do everything.
Genon. I don't know, whatever. It was one. They attributed it to one guy. So in Enoch, we have that same thing going on.
So what we're going to do...
But with different names.
We're going to start from Enoch chapter 6.
Yeah.
Which is actually fragments... This is according to R.H. Charles, and I think everybody agreed with this. These are actually fragments from an older book that we no longer have.
The Noah.
The Book of Noah.
Okay, I didn't realize this was one.
This is part of the Noah fragments.
That's the weird thing is that, a lot of this stuff, so that might actually make more sense, too, because he actually survived the flood, you know?
Yeah.
Enoch was taken up. Anyway.
Yeah, good point.
So these guys, all see the women, the daughters of men down there doing their thing. They're beautiful.
Oh, yeah.
And
they're beautiful.
They're like, let's choose wives. And then this guy, Sunjaza, who's the leader, he says, I fear you won't go with me and do this.
So okay, their leader. So their leader's name is Semjaza, but just so you know, I mean, it's all. You can like look this.
It's all Greek to me.
You can Google this. There's like the guy's name is Shemihaza, Semjaza, Semyaza. It's just the way Hebrew works, right? But in this text, Charles writes it with a J, so it's not Shemi. We're not going to say Shemihaza. We're going to say Semjaza for now on.
Yeah, so you in the comments that are complaining.
Yeah, no one complained about the actual name of the guy. We know that there's a billion different names for this guy.
Yeah, we're just going with the... But anyway, so Semjaza, who is their leader, said unto them, I fear you will not indeed agree to do this deed, and I alone shall have to pay the penalty of a great sin.
Well, because they're all like, man, let's go... Hey, Semjaza. Should we say Shemihaza since it sounds better? No. Semjaza. Let's go down there and experience human life.
Yeah.
Right? Or the life of these people who don't live up here with us in the mountains.
Oh, we gotta make sure to emphasize that in this version, and the angels, the children of heaven, this is saying that they're angels, children of heaven.
Yeah. Should we mention that now, or should we keep
we
on going?
We just did.
Okay.
Too late. Anyway, well, no, I'm just saying, so in the book of the lost books, they actually say that the sons of God that were up on the mountain were angels.
Correct.
But they were humans, but God considered, anyway.
God loved them. God loved them so much that he considered them angels.
Yeah.
That's what it says.
They were so righteous. Anyway, so they're up there looking down, and even in the book of Adam and Eve, it was 100 people. And they decided, we're going down. And then, but Semjaza says, hey, I don't want to be, you know, it's kind of like, let's go.
Me. Don't
let's
blame
go.
Me
and all of a sudden you're walking down, and all of a sudden he turns around, nobody's behind him, you know?
Semjaza was kind of one of the leaders, and he didn't want to take the blame for it.
So they all decided, let us all swear an oath and bind ourselves by mutual imprecations not to abandon this plan but to do this thing.
I love this is the part that I love that they're basically making an oath, a pact here. Yeah. I think that there's a few times in these religious texts or these stories that people, when they're up to no good, they make an oath.
They want to make sure that other people are with them. Well, but then they want to bind other people, you know, because they don't want to be the only... I think part of an oath is to keep it secret, but also so others will have to bear the blame, too. They don't want to be alone.
This won't be me. This is all of us.
And so they all swear together and bound themselves.
And it was 200 of them.
Yeah. And this is in the days of Jared, just like it was in...
Right.
Oh.
And,
yeah.
And the word Jared means... The name Jared, in Hebrew, means to descend or to go down. And so, I think that the text does a play on words here with these sons of God or these angels descending from the mountain in the days of Jared. Basically, the text is basically saying, and they descended... In the days of the dissension.
Oh, yeah. Who descended in the days of Jared, which means descend.
To descend.
To descend. And then what was the thing that you said on the summit of Mount Hermon, and they called it Mount Hermon because they had sworn and bound themselves by mutual imprecations.
Yeah, Hermon comes from the Hebrew, I don't know what it's, if it's, I don't want to say harem, because harem means something, but I think that's another, I think in the Hebrew, the word harem means like a curse, or something else related to that, something destructive is what harem means, and it's basically,
so they cursed on Cursed Mountain, or swore on Swear Mountain, kind of thing, you know, kind of another play on words.
Good, that's right. We don't see that, though, in English because we've lost that play on words. But there's a play on words there.
So it's not just a
dumb... Let it be known, the play on words.
Let it be known.
Yeah.
I wonder why I wrote this. So anyway, so these guys had all these crazy names. There was...
They're basically angel names.
You know, Semi-Azaz.
So besides Shemi... We call him Semjaza. Besides Semjaza and like two other names like Armoros and another one.
Yeah, they all end in L.
They all end with L, which is basically the protocol for an angel name.
Like of God or something?
Well, L means God, right?
So, yeah.
So it's basically the protocol. Michael, Uriel, Gabriel, Raphael. Those are the four horsemen, right? Or the four angels.
Yeah.
I'm not the four horsemen, I'm joking. But...
And this one, they have
Uriel.
Is that the one?
Yeah. But then all these names, they give 19 names here at first. They're supposed to be 20. They actually forgot to put one in. But they give all these names.
And there's 200 guys. They were the captains of 10.
Chiefs of 10. Yeah.
Yeah. But then they only do 19.
So we're not going to go through the list of names.
Yeah, it doesn't.
But they're all something L, mostly. So let's talk about what they do. This is what's interesting.
Okay.
And this is what differs from the book of Adam and Eve, the second book of Adam and Eve. Because in the second book of Adam and Eve, what did we say his name was? Ganon?
Yeah.
Ganon teaches them to do everything wrong.
Yeah.
And right, actually, which is weird. But, like, Ganon teaches them to work with metal. He teaches them to do musical instruments.
Yeah, he does it all.
He teaches them herbology.
He's the one that goes, let's go to the bottom of the mountain and... lure him down too.
Yeah.
He's wired. They're
all the blames on him.
I think he's the devil.
Yeah.
Like I think he's actually the devil figure. He wasn't an actual human.
Okay, he's the possibly. Azazel in this one.
Yeah.
Okay.
Maybe.
And so the story's a little bit different, but we had the same thing. So basically, in this story, amongst these different angels that we talked about, or sons of God, or whatever they are. They each teach them different things.
Yeah, so they all go down, chose themselves wives.
Yeah, they gotta
defiled themselves with them, and they taught them charms, enchantments, the cutting of roots, and made them acquainted with plants. One thing it says is they became pregnant and they bare giants. Oh, this is why I have this written here. Well,
you figured out how tall they were.
So these guys came down, these angels or whatever, or men of God from right. They came down. They got these.
Should we call them Nephilim?
Nephilim
for now on, so that we're not deciding if they're angels
Nephilim,
or not.
Nephilim, yeah. Because then, okay. So what does Nephilim mean? Fallen.
To
fall.
Nephilim means to fall. So Nephilim means the ones that fell.
Yeah, okay. So these Nephilim, this group of men, went to the women, and those women bear giants whose height was 3,000 ells.
So okay. Mark did research about what this means.
I did the math. Okay, so an ell is basically a cubit.
And a cubit is from here to here, right?
Yeah, from the bottom of your elbow to the tip of your finger.
Okay.
Which generally is 17.6 inches.
All right.
These giants are 3,000 ells, 3,000 cubits. So you gotta think. Yeah, 3,000 L's. So if an L is 17.6 inches, they end up being 52,800 inches, which is 4,400 feet. Okay. So, and I look at this. The Empire State Building is 12,500 feet tall.
Also, each of them is about that, about a third of the Empire State
Building. No, the Empire State Building is about a third of their height. So this is this ridiculous number where you're like, and in other texts they like, actually, I was reading in the Book of the Giants, they were saying 450 feet. You know, they knocked off.
And 450 feet is a crazy height for any creature, but it's a lot better than
4,000 feet. I'm trying to think. Blue whales, like, they're, I don't know how big they are, but they have to live in water because it make, you know, there's no way they could live on land being that heavy.
Sure.
So even if they were 45 feet tall, even if you knocked another zero off, 45 feet tall, imagine how, I mean, that's taller than this house. You know, because this is like 20.
This is a two-story house.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, we're up here. Whoa. But, but they come up with this crazy number of, can you imagine, like, if, how that would even work?
Unfortunately, this is the worst part of this book.
Yeah, this is where I think it loses people, because they're like, what? No way. There's no way.
I really like this text. I like the Book of Enoch, and I like the different cool things about it. But it's kind of like the author, this author plural, depending on the one or more authors of this book, they kind of ruined it in a way by making these giants 4,000 feet tall.
It's not even realistic. Yeah, it's
and they came out of a woman, too.
Like, I mean, imagine that, as if birth wasn't hard enough, but also, like, first off, carrying that baby. Anyway,
it's a total fictional.
This is where it's just so easy. When you hear that, it's so easy just to dismiss the whole book when there's such good stuff in here.
So let's not talk about the giants and how tall they were anymore.
Well, anyway, I just wanted to take that because I was like, oh my gosh, this is because, you know, when you think of giants, you think of somebody taller than a two-story house. You know, that's a giant.
Or even like you're 12 feet tall, you know, you're Goliath or something.
Yeah, Goliath was like 10 and a half feet or something. I'm okay like with, a giant.
I'm okay with that. I'm okay with believing that. But
4,000. But that, then it makes sense that how easy it would be for them to eat all their food and stuff. Anyway, so that they talk about later. So anyway, so there's these big people, you know, whether they're
great.
It's saying
great men.
And yeah. Women. Oh yeah, the Bible says great men.
Yeah.
Yeah, which it actually might be closer to the truth. But it says that the giants who consumed all the acquisitions of men, and when men could no longer sustain them, the giants turned against them and devoured mankind, and they began to sin against birds and beasts and reptiles and fish, and devour one another's flesh and drink blood. And then the earth laid accusation against the lawless ones. So whether they're, I take it as kind of the men of great renown and stuff.
Yeah.
That these men are using other people, the things that they're growing, and they're just devouring them themselves.
It's kind of like they're referring to the beginning of an unequal civilization.
Yeah.
And a civilization.
Yeah. Like they made themselves kings.
Yeah.
Or something. You know, to where you lay a tax on somebody, they're forced to give it to you. You're devouring their food, because remember Adam and Eve, by the sweat of thy brow shalt thou earn thy bread all the days of thy life.
Good quote, man.
So these guys are, by the sweat of somebody else's brow, earning their bread and just wasting it too.
And then they get to the point when they're like, oh man, we can't sustain this anymore. And then they start like, I don't know, I don't want to like interpret this too
no,
much.
No, it says that they devour one another's flesh.
Yeah, they start becoming just absolutely horrendous to each other, to the earth, to everything
around. Yeah.
And,
Well, see, and that's, that makes more sense, kind of their, like, their monstrousness. And maybe that's the whole thing about the giant thing. They're just monsters. Like, monstrous.
Yeah.
And
scary.
Actually, in...
Scary.
Oh, that's in the Book of the Giants. They talk about these monsters that are created. But anyway.
Does the camera look crooked? Is it crooked?
No. I don't know.
Just making sure the camera wasn't crooked.
Is this
sorry.
A side note? Is that... Okay, so anyway, so there's the whole, there's the main thing with the, with these, what happened with these things, but then,
Azazel, let's go to,
the earth lays accusation against the lawless ones, and this is, and I, it kind of goes, yeah, let's talk about Azazel, where
so
it talks
Azazel,
about what happened.
Azazel, who was not on the first list.
Yeah.
Of these Nephilim, or these fallen ones.
Mm-hmm.
Azazel was not on that list, but he seems to be kind of like the worst of them.
He's the one that's teaching everybody how to do things, but he's not, he's teaching them how, but it's not saying that he's doing anything.
No, he's not. So
that's why.
And he's not listed amongst the ones that went down either.
So...
So we have suspicions about who Azazel is.
So what is he... What is he... Yeah.
Azazel teaches men. And Genin gets all the credit for this in the Book of Adam and Eve. But Azazel teaches men to make swords and knives and shields and breastplates. And basically working metal, right?
Uh-huh.
And the art of making even, like, jewelry and stuff.
Yeah.
Using...
And...
And is there more?
Well, no.
And the use of there's
beautifying of the eyelids.
What does that mean?
And all kinds of costly stones. So makeup.
Okay, yeah.
Wait, did you think it meant something else?
No. I just missed that line. So Azazel teaches them to start doing industry with metals and stuff and
Well, the first thing leads to war. The first thing is he's teaching them to make swords, knives. So The first thing they're emphasizing is the less practical use, or the deadly, or is the most deadly use of...
Yeah, it didn't say he taught them to make horseshoes.
Yeah.
Right?
He taught them to shoe the horse.
They skipped that, and he went right to, like, making weapons and stuff.
Yeah. So, I mean, he's... it says... Because of the things that he taught, much arose much godlessness, committed fornication, were led astray, became corrupt in all their ways. And then in the next one, so that's what
Azazel
teaches, like really destructive things. Some of them really destructive, like the making of weapons and stuff. But then Senjaza teaches
root cutting, right? Where's Senjaza?
Yeah, enchantments and root cutting. I'm like,
I don't know what root cutting.
I didn't look it up. I thought maybe I was hoping you would have something.
I can imagine what it is.
Armaros, the result. Okay, so these guys, we don't have to go through, but Senjaza teaches enchantments, root cuttings. Another one teaches the resolving of enchantments. So one's teaching to do enchantments. The other one is teaching to resolve those enchantments to break the evil, you know, like the evil eye or something.
Okay.
Like,
oh,
where,
yeah.
And, but then if you do something, like...
I got it.
Like, it's like that thing where you do that, where you do the circle, and then they have to break it.
Yeah,
and you get hit on.
What's that called? It's a... it's a dispel.
Yeah, to dispel, yeah. So, one's teaching how to make enchantments, the other one's teaching somebody how to break enchantments.
They gotta know how to do both. Yeah.
One's teaching astrology, not astronomy, astrology.
Mm-hmm.
So the movement of the stars and how they affect your life, right?
Yeah. That's Brachio who does that. What I think is interesting is most of these guys' names, their name actually is
related to the...
Well, Kokob means star. So Kokob means star in Hebrew. So Kokobel is doing the constellations, right?
Okay.
I think
Ezekiel
does the clouds. I don't know what that root word is.
It means fluffy white.
Yeah, I bet.
I believe Arachiel, the signs of the earth. Another one's teaching the signs of the sun.
And that's what the sun is. What's sun?
Samsiel.
Is sun a Shema? Is it Shema?
I don't know.
Sun. So yes, Shemasiel, the signs of the sun. Sariel is the moon. So yeah.
You know, I think in the first where they had mentioned them, I think that somewhere I saw they had the list names. Anyway, so they're teaching all this. The thing is that you got Azazel teaching like these destructive things. You got these other guys teaching kind of these weird things. You know what I'm saying?
Well, weird, but also somewhat practical.
Well, yeah, like, but I'm saying like they're teaching, yeah, the signs of the sun, the course of the moon.
I don't see anything wrong. Just like I didn't see anything wrong with some of the music that Genon taught in the Book of Adam and Eve. I think it's interesting. And I don't know if that's your point, but Azazel goes and teaches them all these bad things, and then everybody else is teaching them like really cool things that they might not have known already.
Like root cuttings. But yeah. I think that these things that they're teaching are related to kind of
forbidden stuff.
Yeah. It's not saying that they're, oh, well, he taught him about how the sun, you know, whatever. He's talking, they're teaching ways to interpret maybe things like, oh, the sun's doing this, that means that this is going to happen. I'm trying to think of what the word is.
There's a good chance when this, yeah, like, basically, zodiac and stuff.
You got to run your life by this.
Fortune reading and stuff.
Like that reading of entrails or something, you know,
I think that at the time that this text was written, the this astrology and root cutting and all these things that it mentions were seen as forbidden and evil.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, why not? Just like, they taught them astrology.
Well, and it could have been...
Who would do that?
Well, but, I mean, it could be like... If you combine astrology and all these signs and stuff with weapons of war, they might... Like, you're looking for a sign, all of a sudden, oh, well, this is the... I can go attack them because I have fortunes on my side.
Yeah, I guess they...
I don't know.
They took... that. I think we probably went too long on that.
Yeah.
They probably took... Well, I think what the point is they took this civilization and they really, like, turned it around and made them a lot more complex.
Yeah.
And that's bad. At least according to this text.
Well, and it... For some reason, the things that they're teaching them are forbidden or are secrets from heaven, too.
They were secrets.
Anyway,
and so later on, Michael, Uriel, Raphael, and Gabriel, the four angels that is mentioned on and off through this text, they're looking down from heaven and they're like, well, the first, obviously the blood shed is wrong, right? So they're like, hey, there's a lot of bloodshed happening here. This is really bad. We need to do something about this.
Mm-hmm. So they go.
They do. They go to the. They go to the Most High. They say, "Hey, Most High God."
Most High God.
Most. I think it's what it says, right?
He says, "Bring our case before the Most High."
Yeah. And we need to. What are they? I don't know. Basically, what? Tell them.
Here's what they said. One of the things they say is, "Thou seest what Azazel hath done and hath taught all unrighteousness on earth and revealed the eternal secrets which were preserved in heaven." So Azazel, that's one of the things we're reporting. Senjaza, you know, he's influencing him. The women have born giants. The whole earth is filled with blood and unrighteousness. So they're growing up. They're following the line. They're like, we don't know what to do. What do you want us to do? That's basically.
So we go verse 10 where he says, go to the son of Lamech.
Yeah.
Okay. So God, I think it's God, right?
The Most High.
The Most High and the Greatest says, he tells Uriel to go to the son of Lamech, who is that Enoch or Noah?
Oh, it's got to be Enoch.
Go to the son of Lamech, right? And then go, because Noah was a son of Methuselah, right?
Yeah.
So go to the son of Lamech.
And tell
Enoch. So go to Enoch and tell him to go to Noah.
Wait, go to the son of who?
Lamech.
Noah is the son of Lamech.
Okay. We suck at this. So Uriel sent Uriel to Noah.
Yeah, because he says, yeah, go to Noah, tell him. They say right here, tell him, in my name hide thyself, reveal to him the end is approaching, the whole earth will be destroyed. A deluge is about to come on the whole earth and will destroy it. Anyway, so that's one of the things that they're told to do.
That's Uriel's task.
The right. Other one is...
do Raphael's task. He's next, right?
Raphael
is to bind... Think of Ninja Turtles?
Yeah.
Raphael is to bind Azazel.
Oh, yeah.
To bind him hand and foot and to basically cast him into the earth and, like, cover him up. Basically, seal him to his doom in the earth, right?
Yeah, but is that being literal...
I don't know how many things here are literal.
Well, okay, so anyway, so they're... Well, let's get to where... Because they go into a lot of whole earth. When did they send them to Gabriel, Mishid against...
When do they go to outer darkness?
No, when does Enoch come into... Because they're... Oh, wait, it's in the next...
Chapter 12.
Okay, so anyway, we kind
of... Because this is actually not the book of Enoch right here. This is
the book of Noah. So there's all this stuff going on. And, well, do we want to... And Enoch gets called. He has a dream. I'm kind of losing my... Watchers called me, Enoch the scribe, and said to me, Enoch, thou scribe of righteousness, go declare to the watchers of the heaven who have left the high heaven, the holy eternal place, and have defiled themselves with women, and have done as the children of earth do, and have taken unto themselves wives. And he tells them what to say. Hey.
Go tell them this.
He tells them to say, you have wrought great destruction on the earth, and they shall have no peace nor forgiveness of sin, and inasmuch as they delight themselves in their children, the murder of their beloved ones shall they see, and the destruction of their children shall they lament, and shall make supplication unto eternity. But mercy and peace shall ye not obtain. Okay, so Enoch's task is... to go and
intercede.
Well, and to tell them, hey, you guys are being wicked. You guys, oh, you know what? Actually, though, another thing where they talk about what they're doing on the earth, because I don't want to skip it.
Like, what do you mean what they're doing?
What the unrighteous, let's call them, are doing on the earth is in 69.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Oh, 69, dudes. Okay.
Yeah, in 69, it's out of order.
Yeah. So that's one of the things is that this book is so, like...
So So chapter
fragmented.
Chapter 69 is also originally part of the Book of Noah as well. But when the scribes and people who put together Enoch put it together, they did their best to put it in the order they thought it should be.
Yeah.
Obviously, 69 was... It should be back where we were just at.
Yeah. But they have different names, too.
Yeah, they get the names
so
wrong.
So, this is... But we're just trying to show you what exactly state the Earth was in and what Enoch was having to deal with, you know, what these people were doing. The one who led astray all the sons of God and brought down to the earth, led them through the daughters of men. So some of the things he imparted to the holy sons of God, evil counsel, led them astray so that they defied. See, this is the one where I think they're talking about their actual angels. They're just, anyway. Led them astray so that they defiled their bodies with the daughters of men. And the third was named Gadriel. He it was that showed the children of men all the blows of death. And he led astray Eve and showed the weapons of death to the sons of men. The shield, the coat of mail, and the sword of battle, and all the weapons of death to the children of men. And the fourth was named Penae. He taught the children of men the bitter and the sweet. This is the weird one.
Yeah.
And he taught them, all the secrets of their wisdom. He instructed mankind in writing with ink and paper. And I was like, that doesn't seem like too bad.
Well, I think, I was picturing that he was teaching basically like how to deceive and how to lead people astray using... poetry, fiction.
Okay. And thereby many sin from eternity to eternity until this day. So kind of...
Well, even till today. Well, of course, it was written in 2000.
Yeah. And...
Because men were not created for such a purpose.
Yeah.
Wow.
To give confirmation to their good faith with pen and ink.
That's interesting.
Yeah, I was like... It was kind of like... Yeah. Well, anyway, so I wanted to get down to this other. The fifth was named Kazdijah.
Yeah, I don't like that one.
What?
It's hard to say.
This is he who showed the children of men all the wicked smitings of spirits and demons, and the smitings of the embryo in the womb, that it may pass away.
Taught them how to do abortions.
Yeah.
Wow.
So, and the smitings of the soul, the bites of the serpent, you know, and all this different stuff. And so there, I thought that was interesting because I was like, what? Abortions back then?
They had their ways.
So anyway, it was just, there's all this stuff going on. I mean, it was a crazy world, kind of like today. Just all kinds, more stuff than you would have thought. You know, you would have thought that their problems would have been a lot simpler, but it was, there was all kinds of stuff going on. So anyway, so where were we? So Enoch is sent to tell them, and now we're going to quickly skip over to the Book of the Giants.
Are we?
Why not?
Yeah, I don't have that.
Well, I'm just saying.
I'll quickly go over this.
Yeah.
Book of Giants was not in was not available to R.H. Charles when he was doing the Book of Enoch, but it was available. It was one of the fragments found in Qumran, in the Dead Sea Scrolls.
Yeah.
So.
Well, anyway, so.
And when I say fragment, it's fairly fragmented.
Oh, it's definitely fragmented, but Millick, Joseph Millick, he actually thinks that this was originally in with the Book of Enoch.
Well, because this,
and there's a whole section of the Book of Enoch that what he doesn't think. Similitudes.
This part, the Book of Giants, covers what we're talking about right now.
Yeah.
So yeah.
Definitely. Yeah. So it's interesting because what happens is that these people that Enoch is going to talk to, they start having dreams, and they start kind of like, what the heck? What's going on? Like, there's a guy, it talks about some of the things, that they're doing, 200 angels chose animals on which to perform unnatural acts, including presumably humans, like unnatural, like actually mixing these different,
they're creating monsters.
Yeah. Like this weird kind of almost like scientific, like, what would that be? I don't know. But they called it miscegenation, which is like mixing or interbreeding, unnatural sexual union kind of stuff. So
yeah, they're creating more powerful beasts.
And so they create these crazy hybrid beasts, you know. Anyway, but that's some of, maybe. But
Minotaur, I think that's where the Minotaur came from.
Oh, could be. Yeah. So then it says that the giants began to be troubled by a series of dreams and visions. And there's this one called Mawe, the Titan.
Yeah, Mawe.
And
Mahaja.
Yeah. Well, that's in
So it's the the same name as Mahaja? Let me write it down.
So he has a dream, and he reports it to his fellow giants. The dream that he has is that there's a...
Yeah.
Oh, okay, so they put in the vowels.
Because there's no J, so it's a Yod. Oh, okay. The Yod and Vav are switched in this one, so it's Mava.
So he has this dream, and there's this tablet with stuff written on it, and then it's drenched in water and it's pulled out, and then there's only there's names written on the tablet, and it's immersed in water, and then when it's lifted out, there's only three names left. The rest have been washed away. So it's like a...
Yeah, it's a type and shadow for the deluge.
Yeah. And then they all meet together and start discussing it. Then a few others have dreams. There's this guy Oye has a dream of a tree that's uprooted, except for three of its roots.
Yeah.
So
another three.
And so, While the Enoch's coming to meet them, they're having these dreams that are disturbing them. They're like, what's going on? Because they're just living their life aborting, killing everybody, you know, doing all this astrology and stuff. And so, in this one, the guy, more dreams afflict the giants. And then they finally say, hey,
Let's go to
Enoch. To Enoch, the noted scribe, and let's go to him, and he will interpret for us the dream. Thereupon, this fellow Oye declared and said to the giants, "Oh, he had a dream." Anyway, and they don't explain the dream, but it was bad enough because suddenly, thereupon, all the giants and monsters grew afraid and called Mawe.
Yeah, they sent him to go talk to Enoch.
And he came to them, and the giants pled to send him to Enoch. So that's kind of this other story that's going on at the same time as Enoch's coming to say, hey, I'm coming to warn you guys. They're having these dreams too, so they send somebody to intercede.
Or it could be just switched, right? Like, these are two different... It's the same story, but one writer writes it as the angels send Enoch to them, and one writer is writing it as the Nephilim are going to him. Right? So the common event is that the Nephilim and Enoch meet and talk.
Yeah.
What one story is sent. One story insists that Enoch was sent to them, and the other story insists that they went to Enoch. It could be just two different stories of the same, you know.
Yeah.
The same event.
Well, yeah, it could be just that they're both ready.
Yeah.
And I'm saying Axiom makes it worse because they're having these dreams and stuff. Enoch's coming to them. They're sending somebody, but then they don't end up changing anything. They're disturbed about this stuff, but all they want to do is have Enoch make intercession with God. They don't necessarily want to. They don't want to change their lives.
No, they're not.
You know what
I'm
saying?
Yeah, I see.
So I don't know. I mean, yeah.
Change is a good thing, by the way. That's the moral of this video, is that people should change.
It's don't kill people.
Don't be crazy. Yeah.
So there's that story. So whether that's but Enoch is coming, and in chapter 13, verse 3, I went and spoke to them all together. And they were all afraid, and fear and trembling seized them, and they besought me to draw up a petition for them that they might find forgiveness, and to read their petition in the presence of the Lord of heaven. And from thenceforward they could not speak with him, nor lift up their eyes to heaven for shame of their sins for which they had been condemned. So I think part of the problem is that they left God, they left the heavenly place, you know,
yeah.
Whether they came down from the mountain,
yeah.
But they fell. That's why we call them the Nephilim.
Nephilim.
That's why you call
Nephal.
Them that?
Nephal.
Oh, Nephilim.
Yeah.
Okay. So,
NFL.
So, yeah. Yeah, if you do it in Hebrew, it's NFL.
NFL, yeah.
Yeah. But, so they're just so caught up in what they're doing, you know, the wickedness and stuff, that they don't feel that they have any kind of standing before God. It sounds
like. They've walked away.
Yeah.
And these are probably the children or the grandchildren of
Seth.
They don't even know God, probably. They're like, hey, can you, you're a God guy, right?
Oh yeah, because they haven't been taught. Yeah.
You're one of God's people. You're like the prophet, right? Can you meet with us? And
it's like, dude, you're 4,400 feet tall. Why don't you just... you're closer to God than me. You know, that's what I would say if I was Enoch. You're right up there, dude.
You can just talk to him face to face.
But anyway, yeah, so they've fallen. They don't... It seems like they understand what their state, but they're asking Enoch to make a petition to God.
Yeah.
You know, because they have shame for their sins, but they don't want to change. This was, you know, shame for their sins, which they had been condemned. And so Enoch writes out their petition. It's like, and then he sits down in Dan, and he reads over their petition, and then he falls asleep, and then
a boring petition, huh?
It was so.
But
he has a vision.
Yes, right. My question is, why would you wouldn't you feel embarrassed to go to God and say, "Hey, these guys want to know. Do you have anything in there? These guys want to know if they're being." Oh, sweet. This is really good. Did we open the last episode? If you didn't see our last one, this is Bundaberg.
Yeah, that was last episode.
So good.
It was so bad.
Stay
away from the Trader Joe's. Sorry.
Sorry. I like Trader Joe's, especially their blue corn.
No, they have good stuff, but the one thing that...
Have you had their blue corn chips?
Mm-hmm.
They're really good.
No, but I'm saying they have a lot. Yeah, they have a lot of good stuff.
What was I saying? I guess it doesn't matter.
Oh.
Oh, wouldn't you be embarrassed to go to God and say, for example, when you're young and we go to your parents and you would ask them for something that you know they're going to say no to, wasn't it kind of like humiliating? Like, you know? So Enoch's going to God and he's like, hey, these guys want to know if they can continue to
do their wickedness.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, that's the thing, is that God sent Enoch to them, right? And
yeah,
it's like, we're going to write up a petition to try to change God's mind. It's kind of funny, like,
yeah.
You know, like online and stuff, people will be signing, sign the petition to whatever, and it's like, I know it makes you feel better, you know, but it doesn't actually change anything. What's that?
Oh, it's just so good. I'm trying to figure out why.
Because they do it right.
Yeah.
Anyway, so just know that petitions don't help.
No.
Or don't always help, because then again, petitions to God have helped, you know, like, oh, well, what if they have 10 righteous? How about, you know?
That happens, right?
What
if there was just one?
It's like that, it's kind of that funny old Jewish thing where it's like they're bargaining, you know? They're actually making a deal with God, like, come on, God, let's sweeten that deal a little bit. But anyway, so this petition, though, Enoch is taken up into heaven, you know, and God says, nah, it's not gonna happen. Sorry. Let's see. I'm trying to think where your petition will not be granted. And this is Enoch coming back to them after Enoch's lifted up into heaven. He says, I wrote out your petition, and in my vision it appeared thus, that your petition will not be granted unto you throughout all the days of eternity, and that judgment has been finally passed upon you.
Your dreams will come to pass.
Huh?
Your dreams will come to pass.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Those dreams that you guys, you know, you sent me up to, that's going to happen. You guys, I mean, he says, previously, previously you have seen the destruction of your beloved sons, and you shall have no pleasure in them, but they shall fall before you by the sword. Your petition on their behalf shall not be granted, nor yet on your own, even though you weep and pray and speak all the words contained in the writings which I have written. So, you're just like, sorry, dudes, not gonna happen. And one thing that he says to them about the petition, he said, oh, you should intercede for men and not men for you. This is kind of later. It's like, he's kind of like, you're asking me to intercede for you. Why aren't you just changing and interceding, stopping all these wars, stopping all this destruction? Anyway.
You know what it is, they had astronomy, astrology. They could tell the future. They had their root cutting and stuff, you know, they had all these things. And basically the sign of the times was there was a comet or something coming, and they could tell. And they knew that their demise was coming, and then they were having these visions and dreams of, like...
Oh, I like that. I like that.
Yeah, and they're like, hey, we're so sorry, we're sorry, we're sorry. It's like, you should've...
But they're not changing, though.
Well, yeah, I mean... Exactly. They're not gonna go out and like give everybody a fair share of land and like make everybody equal. They're not gonna like crumble. They're not gonna tear their palaces down and so they just kind of have to deal with it.
Well, let's maybe yeah.
I don't know why they're worried anyways, because do you think the water's gonna go over 4,400 feet tall?
They're tall enough. They don't even.
I don't know why they're worried anyways.
So here's an end. Do you want to end, kind of?
Yeah, we should end.
Okay, so here's
our viewers.
Here's kind of the Dead Sea Scrolls, an end of what's to come. Until Raphael arrives, behold, destruction is coming. A great flood. And it will destroy all living things and whatever is in the deserts and the seas. And the meaning of the matter upon you for evil. So, but But now loosen the bonds binding you to evil and pray. So that's the end.
Cross your fingers. Like,
pray and kiss your butt goodbye.
Kiss your butt goodbye.
So anyway, that's the interesting.
Raphael would probably would have said cowabunga.
Cowabunga, yeah. Kiss your booties goodbye. Yeah. So there's the interesting story of the Enoch and the giants. You know, which is
a really cool
just
story.
A really interesting, thing. And there it is. So we'll in a future episode. What did you want to talk about? We had some stuff listed.
Yeah, we have
Noah, because this
Noah's
leads
birth.
Us right to the flood.
Yeah, you have
this
Noah's
leads
birth.
This leads us to the destruction. You get you in with the Adam book of Adam and Eve, the book of Enoch, him interceding, them having the visions. It leads us right to Noah. And so there's some interesting stuff in the book of Enoch on Noah, and it's just some weird stuff that happens, some visions he has. But like it says that these are, a lot of this is from the book of Noah.
Yeah.
Fragments of another lost book.
Apparently the book of Jubilees references Noah, and a few other apocalypses. I have mentioned it. I can't remember the details.
Yeah. Well, that's one of the things, too, though, in Enoch, some of the, like, the book of Jasher, or the, you know, actually has, like, I wonder, that was written back in 1600, so it might actually be, anyway, I'm kind of, now I'm thinking of thoughts, like, I was like, because there's some, I don't know what I'm saying, anyway.
You're going off, Mark.
Yeah, why didn't I just stop whenever we read that? I read that cool thing from the Dead Sea Scroll, the Book of the Giants, the end. Anyway, but it leads us right into Noah, and the interesting story there, some of the stuff that you don't get out of the Bible, you know, these weird, fun stories.
Yeah, there's a lot of weirdness in here, but I think there's some gems.
No, I think that's what I'm saying. It makes it interesting because with the Bible, you just have, you know, you just a very watered down or simplified.
So boring.
No, a simplified version where it's kind of the cliff notes.
It's a safe
version. Yeah. But in these other ones, you get
talking about giants and stuff. Even though I did mention it.
They did.
Like, yeah, it's mentioned, the word giants is in Genesis, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So I was like, why mention it, but don't, like, tell about, you know? Like, you're just, like, asking
why no,
for trouble.
Yeah. Okay, so we'll end this right now.
Okay.
It
was close to an hour.
It was?
Yeah.
Dang it.
Do you need my note here? 51 minutes?
Oh, well, maybe we'll try to cut it off. Okay, stop. All right, well, we'll see you next time with more on the Book of Enoch and more on Noah.
Look to the bear.
Oh, that was actually, there's something in here on that.
Is there?
Yeah. Okay.
Get to that too then.
I think it was in here.